morning. Nice to have you come here, wherever you're watching us all around Australia. Well, keep it crossed, Australia. Tonight it could happen. For 2 years, we've waited for Michael Doohan to stand on that podium as the world champion, and Barry Sheene, tonight could be the night. I know we have said this a number of times.
Well, it could have been the night at Donington, couldn't it? But in reality, you'd have to say that tonight's almost certainly, 99%, it's going to go his way, because basically, if you want to work it out, all you have to say is that all Doohan has to do tonight is get 4 points more than Kevin Schwantz, or he has to win the race and beat Schwantz. So,
but you can never write Kevin Schwantz off. I mean, at Donington, there didn't seem to be a hope that Kevin Schwantz could win that after falling the way he did in qualifying and then to come back and take Mick on and from way back in eighth position to win. So you can never write the Texan off.
You can never write him off, but I think here tonight in Czechoslovakia, the circuit doesn't really suit the Suzuki. It never has done. And they've struggled all the way through practice. He's fallen down again trying to get it right. So I think Cadalora is going to be the one that's going to give Mick the trouble tonight.
All right, words from Barry Sheene. He's been there and he's done that. Michael Doohan, well, yesterday after qualifying, he was a little tense, obviously, and he really doesn't want to talk about the championship, but how can you avoid it when you're so close to it? Let's hear what he had to say about his thoughts on the race that we're about to see.
Well, I'd like to win the race regardless. Obviously, I'd like to win the championship as well, but, you know, and obviously I'm thinking about it. I'd be mad to say, or lying to say, that I'm not thinking about it, because, you know, but we have got four races, if we need four races, I guess. So, you know, I'd like to win the championship. I wouldn't necessarily like to win it here. If I could win it anywhere, I'd be happy, you know. But I'll go into tomorrow's race with the same approach I've had all year, is just go in there. If the bike feels good, I feel good, I give it a go. But we don't have to win the race, so I know that. And if there's some guys pushing real hard out there, well, I'll just ride around for the best position I can get.
You've reached your agreement for 1995 with Honda, am I right?
Yeah, I signed back up with them for 95 when I was in Japan doing some promotional work for the 8-hour race.
Just for 1 year?
Again, for 1 year. The first contract I did was 89-90. That was the only two-year contract I've ever had. Ever since then, it's been just year by year. And I think it suits us both, you know. Originally, I asked for just one-year contracts, and, you know, still is the case now, because if I want to move or whatever, I can, and if Honda want me to move, they've got the option too, so it works both ways. And, you know, but by May, June, we've already started to talk about the following year, so it doesn't really cause any concern as, say, come December, I don't know what I'm doing. It's normally all well and truly taking shape by then.
Well, there you go. He sounds very together, doesn't he?
Well, you know, you get obsessed with the fact, I've got to win this world championship. You put your head on the pillow at night and think, oh, I'm not going to think about this. You start going to think, oh, my God. You think about it the whole time, you know, but that's life, you know. Let's keep our fingers crossed. You see there, he's signed with Hondas again, and where you think about it, they couldn't get anybody better, and there was nowhere better for him to go. So it's a good, perfect match, really, isn't it?
Kevin Schwantz, the man who can throw the spanner in the works and normally does, because he's just such an incredible fighter, and he hasn't had the chance to really defend his championship the way he would have liked to. He's still having troubles with the bike. Let's hear from the Texan.
Right now, I think our biggest problem is still with the motorcycle. We've got a bike that's been working pretty well the past couple of places we've been. And you know, here in Checo, it seems like it varies a lot from session to session. So we've got to we can't quite put our finger on what's causing us the trouble, and you know, we've only got another afternoon to try and figure it out.
Is it a place on the circuit that's screwing the whole lap up, or is it just like something completely mysterious?
Well, this afternoon we had a couple of little problems with the engine. We had to come in and make some changes to that. Seems like it's such a long track that you have such a little small amount of time to a small number of laps to test to try and get the bike set up. And you know, I think for me, I slipped off this morning in the warm up or in the practice, and it's a track that's really, really biased towards the front, and right now I can't seem to get the feeling I need from the Suzuki.
It's also a track where this weekend especially you need to do really well.
That's for sure. We've got to, you know, we've got to put ourselves somewhere near the front, with an opportunity to win this race on Sunday, and you know, if we don't, for sure the championship's gone.
Yeah, we did a very good job, the team and everybody. It was working in the right direction, and we made good improvement from yesterday to today. So I'm quite confident for tomorrow. I know Doohan, he did many quick laps during this last practice, but I think we have some chance for tomorrow.
I would say he's got quite a big chance, actually, Daz. All right, well, look, there you go. Luca Cadalora on pole position, second, Mick Doohan, third, John Kaczynski, fourth, Alberto Pooch, rather. Second row of the grid, Doug Chandler, Kevin Schwantz, Itoh Creville. Third row of the grids, Alex Barros, Niall McKenzie, our old mate Abby and Garcia. Championship positions, Mick leading with seven wins from Kevin Schwantz, John Kaczynski, Alberto Pooch, Alex Creville and Alexander Barros.
Well, there you have it. That's the grid, and there's the championship, the way it shapes up, as we said. Mick has really got to score 4 or 5 points tonight. That's what he's got to do. He's really got to finish in front of Kevin Schwantz. Now, how he's going to do that, we're going to see when we come back. Stay with us and keep him crossed. Here we are, bikes out on the warm-up. The parade lap now coming round to grid up, and you'll there the shots from Mick Doohan's Honda. It's a slightly different colour this time round, Barry. It seems to have a different number plate colour scheme. It's now a white background.
Yeah, it looks like the whole fairing is a different... it was mainly white and red before, and now it's a lot darker. There's some blue in it and that. And I would imagine... one of the reasons behind doing that, if Doohan is going to clinch the World Championship, maybe they're launching some new kind of bike, some new kind of four-stroke or two-stroke or whatever. And if all the posters of Mick Doohan as World Champion are around, then it's nice to have it the same as a new road bike. That's what Suzuki used to do. As to whether this Honda's do the same, I don't know. But it looks like you can recognise it a lot easier.
Talk me through the Brno circuit. It looks terribly, terribly good.
Well, as far as the circuit is concerned, it's great. It's got brilliant runoffs. I've never raced here. I raced on the old circuit, which was death track, basically. There's a new colour scheme there. It's just really nice in that it goes uphill and down Dale. There's fast sort of uphill sections, and most of the corners are fast. You know, there's no little Mickey Mouse chicanes or anything. The riders basically... say they enjoy riding there. It's always been a favourite track of the Yamaha 500. Goes very, very well here, as do the Dunlops on the 500s here. So that could all bode well for Cadalora, being on a Yamaha and being on Dunlops.
Wonderful setting, isn't it?
It's great. You know, it's the most enthusiastic sports people of virtually anywhere when you go to Czecho. It's a great place.
120,000 packed around the circuit, 22 laps, 5.394 kilometres. The race distance, 118.668 kilometres.
It's going to be very interesting to watch the first three or four laps of this, to watch how people's bikes slide around and that, because you'll get a good idea. It's all a bit of a punt as to what tyre compounds people have fitted. So you might see somebody tear off like a rat up a drainpipe, but it's, you know, you won't know what's going on until after about four or five laps. Vitally important not to get left behind here, and watch Kaczynski off the line.
So Kevin Schwantz, you rode with him as he took his position on the grid, middle of the second row, front row. Very interesting makeup of machinery and riders here. Mick Doohan, well, if he can just win this championship. We've talked about it for so long, and it's haunted him. A big lead he had, of course, before breaking the leg, and now fully fit again and riding beautifully. Okay, set for a start. There we go. Everybody gets away well, and nobody's jumped the start that time round.
Yeah, that was all pretty even, wasn't it? Right, let's have a look.
Kaczynski's got away well. Yeah, Pooch leads in first up. He's been consistent, hasn't he?
Yeah, great. Really good. It looks... you might also see a good ride from Chandler here as well, because he's had a lot of problems with the Kajiva in practice. And tyre troubles and that. So hopefully, if they've got it all squared away, you might see a good result from him.
Doing on four there. You can see that new colour scheme we talked about. It throws you first up when you look at it. We're so used to seeing it the other way around. A little bit of dodgy stuff at the back of the field. We're more interested in what's happening up front. That's from Mick Doohan's bike.
You see, that's Pooch in front on another factory Honda. And you see, when they get on the straight, the difference between the out and out sort of Mick is the number one factory rider, but you won't see Mick Doohan's bike 20 mile an hour quicker than Pooch's bike or Preville's bike down the straight.
Devon Schwantz still fair way back. We'll pick it out for you as he comes past.
I don't think you're going to see anything good from Schwantz tonight because they've had terrible troubles to see their Cadalora up into third position now. He's the danger man tonight. You know, really, you'd have to say that the man that's going to play a major role tonight would be Cadalora.
Fantastic shot here from Doohan's bike. He's really right up the exhaust pipe of Pooch. Look at this. Great camera stuff here. You can't get much closer than riding with him there. And almost a touch. So Doohan hunting up for second place. Cadalora all over the back of it. It's Kosinski. So the Kajiba's up into the business end of this race already.
They get a slipstream up here. You see, look, there's little or nothing between the speed of the bikes.
That's good, though.
Oh, it's great. Makes for good, fair competition. Yeah, Doohan's having a bit of a struggle to get past Pooch because Pooch is going quick, although not quite as quick as Doohan. And it's always a real struggle when you've got someone that is virtually as quick as you, maybe up the inside, mate.
So some nice pitches here from Doohan's bike. You can see the battle he's having with Pooch.
If Doohan gets a good run out of this, up this hill, and then over the crest of the hill into the left-hander, I would say at the top of this hill, up the inside.
Great shot as Pooch weaving away around in front of him.
Oh, close stuff.
So Doohan's still second, then it's Cadalora, then it's John Kosinski.
Arby. Whoa, dear me, that was tight.
Arby is up there in fifth spot.
Oh, really?
Fell down at Donington and couldn't go on with the race there when he was drafted into the team to race the Yamaha, but already up in the fifth place. He is a great talent, isn't he? I mean, he's very fast.
Well, he's a real trial. There's no doubt about that. And don't forget, he obviously is getting used to the Yamaha. He's never seen the race circuit here or any of the other Grand Prix circuits come to that. Cadalora is looking for a way past Doohan, and Doohan is just at the moment just sizing up to see where he can get past Pooch. And in the meantime, while he's sizing Pooch up, you might see Cadalora nip past somewhere.
Wonderful stuff here. You can't get much closer to Pooch than what you are there. Doohan, of course, he can't breach him at a straight line speed, as Barry's explained. Both Hondas on equal power.
Maybe. Oh. This is where he almost did it the lap before. Yes, got him.
So Doohan now leads the Czech Republic Grand Prix. And look at Cadalora. He'll want to get past Pooch now to get in touch with Doohan. Doohan can use this to his advantage. If he knows that Cadalora's got to get past Pooch. He knows how hard it was for him to get past.
Actually, it's all pretty bunched up, isn't it? So you see there, 8 is Creville. He's had terrible problems right around the outside.
Here we go.
This is just a replay. This is where Doohan nearly touched Pooch the lap before. You see Pooch goes out a little bit wider than Doohan does there, and Doohan just up the inside, pops from the inside.
Gee, they're good pitches, aren't they?
Mm, lovely. I wonder if Cadalora got past Pooch.
Well,
just
no,
here.
A tick.
Just here, if he was going to do it.
There we go.
He didn't.
So Pooch still in second place. Mick Doohan's in first. Then it's Cadalora in third. Kosinski up in fourth. I'm not getting a long enough shot to be able to pick up where Schwantz is, but he's nowhere near the front, I can tell you that.
I'm just having a look, see if I can
see. He's in 10th. 10th spot. 10th spot. Well back. So Mick Doohan now starting away with a little bit of a gap because Cadalora having the same trouble that Doohan had to get round Pooch.
Yeah, it was pretty evenly matched between Pooch and did Cadalora. Yes, got him.
So Cadalora now goes up in a second place. He rounds up Pooch. Now chases Doohan. Great battle tonight from the 500s. This is good stuff.
Wow, you see the acceleration, the Yamaha out of there, pulling away from Pooch. Cadalora pulled out and over fist from Pooch there. See, Itoh's coming up well, number seven there. He fell off in practice and banged himself around a bit, but he's had some good rides here, Itoh, so he likes the circuit, and any kind of luck, we'll get a real good battle.
Well, you can already see that Cadalora now has dropped off Poos once he got past it. He's already pretty well on the tail of Mick Doohan's Honda. Kaczynski now, he's up, but he's now been challenged. So Kaczynski just passed by Itoh. Good battle this Baz tonight.
Yeah, great. I was just looking, you know, as I said at the beginning, I don't think Schwantz is going to figure anywhere in it, because they've had monumental problems with it, with the bike in practice, 10th place behind Barros. And Abbey in 7th, that's pretty good going. Yeah, I just can't see that you don't put them in the truck and they heal up overnight. You know, they just, it's, you know, you don't stick a Band-Aid on, it'll be all right in the morning. It's something that when they're bad, they're bad. And the Yamaha around here has always been good. The Dunlops around here have always been good. So when Mick gets the information from his pit, obviously if he can win the race, he'll win it. But I don't think he'll pull out all stops to beat Cadalora. If Cadalora is on a mission, then he has no reason to.
Massive crowd here around this circuit, and we could be seeing the Australian as the world champion elect. Around they come again, and you can see Cadalora. Now Itoh, big move from him, Poos back into fourth. Then we've got Kaczynski. So Poos really is starting to drop back a little bit, being claimed by the pack. Bullet start from him. Terrific start. Gravillo now puts a lot of pressure on Kaczynski.
Yes, got him.
And got him nicely too. Gee, they're all on the charge, aren't they?
They are, because it's getting near the sharp end of the season. And don't forget, it's contract negotiation time. And, Kaczynski got him back again.
Didn't last long.
That's the slow-mo of Greville getting it, but the most interesting one was,
flew off there.
Yeah, maybe his knee pads.
Yeah, it could have been too.
You see, Itoh, he's not hanging about because he's caught that light up quite easily, third, and he could pull the surprise of the day, Itoh.
Well, you see there, now as they come through, that Kaczynski has taken back that spot again. That's a good dice between those two. Place down the straight again, it's still Mick Doohan.
But look how close Itoh is.
He really has pulled it out tonight, hasn't he? Big race. So they are doing Cadalora, Itoh, Poos, Greville, Kaczynski, Arby, Chandler, Barros and Schwantz. Kevin Schwantz way out of it tonight on the Suzuki. And that's good news for us. And that's not being a derogative to the world champion. There's Poos, Greville, Kaczynski. So as they come round in front of this massive crowd in the Czech Republic, we'll take a break, come back, stay with us. We could have a champ on our hands. Great news for Australia. Michael Doohan still in front from Luca Cadalora. Itoh riding very well tonight. Greville and Poos having a ding-dong. And Kaczynski, there he is there. Well, Poos has been passed by just about everybody. He really has been tenacious in trying to hold him off. It's got plenty of poke down in the straight line, but having a bit of trouble around the back of the circuit. They round him up.
Abby's going well. Yeah, it's 56. That's Abby. He's going good. You know, he's obviously steadied up a bit since Donington Park.
Let's just refresh people's memories, because at Suzuka he was sensational. He really pushed all of the top guys and finally threw it into the kiddie litter. And then, of course, at Donington, we really didn't see much of him because he dropped it in qualifying.
Well, he's done a very unusual move for a Japanese rider, in that he was sort of brought on the scene by Honda and by Oguma, who's the boss of HRC, the Honda Racing Corporation, and sort of nurtured in motocross and brought into road racing and that. And then he's dropped a blockbuster. There's Dick, that's Mick's mechanic there, or one of his mechanics. And he's dropped Honda and gone to Yamaha, which has taken everybody really by surprise, especially in Japan.
Yeah, so having another fine ride, let's hope he can keep it together and finish this time round, because he's obviously very, very quick. As Barry said, 56 has not seen any of these circuits. He's had little experience on a 500.
Oh, good move, Itoh. Yeah. Smooth move, nice.
It's the best we've seen Itoh for a while tonight. He really is on the money.
He's gone well here before, you know, and last year he was having problems because he was running a fuel-injected bike and that. And this is everything that Mick could want with, as long as he doesn't come up and start fighting with Mick. But that's great, you know, that's the ideal thing for Mick. Because if Mick can pull a little bit of ground on Itoh now, then Itoh can fight with Cadalora, and that's just the way it should be.
Even if Itoh throws out a challenge, I don't think it's going to worry Mick, because he's got the championship in his sights. He would really know where Kevin Schwantz is. Schwantz is still back in 10th place. Here's the move.
That's a good move. That's nice stuff. This circuit is very, very hard on front tyres. A lot of the corners, you break into the corner. You know, the majority of racing circuits, you break into straight line and sort of lay it into a corner. But this circuit, you're really working the front tyre a lot. You're braking as you're going into the corner. So consequently, a lot of people have suffered really badly from lack of front tyre grip and a front tyre shredding itself after sort of 10 laps or something.
Which is exactly the reason that Sponsor's back in 10th place. He can't get the front of the bike to respond.
Well, that's it. I mean, anything but the front. I mean, you can cope with the back end going all over the show, but once the front end goes, or if you're not sure about, you know, you can't put it into a corner and brake late and know that front end's going to stick, that is really unnerving.
Hondas look absolutely stunning in a new wardrobe. I like it.
Well, it's good. At least you can recognise them now, because they all look... you can read the numbers a lot better now.
Oh, they look great. So Itoh up into second place. Cadalora is third. Kravillan, Kosinski, Pooj. He's dropping back. RB now is there in seventh. And Chandler, Barros and Schwantz still in 10th place. 15 laps to go, a long way to go yet, but doing in command at the moment from Itoh. Cadalora, the pole sitter, back into third. You heard from Cadalora just after qualifying. He's very happy with the bike.
It looks Mick's just pulling out a little bit of ground now on Itoh. And you look at the distance between Mick and Cadalora. He's pulled out some ground there. So once he gets the signal that he's pulled out a little bit, he'll press on for another lap. And if he can pull out a bit more, then put the pressure on for five or six laps and hopefully have it made.
So doing Itoh, Cadalora, Honda, Honda and Yamaha. And as you're right, I mean, riding shotgun your teammate, that's not a bad situation to be in. And they are opening a gap up on Cadalora. But you know, then he comes back.
I was thinking about if Kojiva do retire from Grand Prix at the end of this year, even if they don't retire, in actual fact, I wouldn't mind betting that the Roberts team will take Chandler next year. Because that's originally he did ride for the Roberts lot. And Chandler is riding good again now. And my money would be on Chandler going to Roberts next year.
So Cadalora trying to wring the Yammy's neck to get back in touch with Mick Doohan. He's got Itoh to get round first, and they are opening up a gap. But then he seems to close it up on the other part of the circuit. They seem to drop him off here, but he certainly comes back. But Doohan absolutely flying at the moment.
Yeah, it's just going to be interesting as the race goes on.
This is from Kevin Swanson Suzuki.
Yeah, it's as the race goes on, just to watch the wheels of Doohan's bike, Cadalora's bike, Itoh's. And because this circuit really gets to the tyres after sort of half distance, then the tyres start to go off and they go off very, very quickly. So just keep your eyes open as we get sort of three parts of the way through.
Riding with a world champ, Kevin Schwantz.
Well, that sums up the Suzuki's round Brno. I mean, they've just got blown away, not because of Barros or Schwantz's riding, just by sheer virtue of the fact that the bike isn't right for Brno.
You've got to feel sorry for Schwantz, because he is such a fierce competitor and he really hasn't been able to defend his championship the way he would like.
No, it's true, but that's the luck of the draw. You know, it's
it happens a lot, though, doesn't it?
It does.
You win a championship and you really don't get to fight for it again.
Yeah, it's true.
So Barros and Schwantz, they're having their own private war, and Barros has got the best of the champ at the moment.
Oh, I don't think Kevin will be worrying too much. He knows there was no chance of being up the front. So he'll just ride around with Alex for the race, and then the last couple of laps, if he can get past him and get away, jolly D. I mean, you get yourself a ninth place or a tenth place. It doesn't really bother you that much when you're talking about fighting for ninth or tenth.
Mick Doohan, though, doing it the right way at the moment. He's got his teammate Itoh tucked in behind him, riding shotgun for him. Cadalora on the Yamaha. There's nothing in it. One mistake and they can slip through, but Doohan looks pretty good, doesn't he? Looks nice and cool and calm and collected. Well on the ragged edge.
Yeah, I was looking. Mick seems to be picking the bike up a little bit to try and keep it up as straight as he can, just there especially, to stop sort of tearing the side of the tyre apart. I've just noticed that a couple of corners he comes out and just picks the bike up sort of mid-corner before he really gets the power on hard. I don't know whether you'd be able to see it coming out of here. No, you wouldn't. But when you get a good front-on shot, you can see that he's definitely picking it up a little.
Nice pictures from Michael Doohan's bike. Out in front, they come over the crest of the hill again. Cadalora perhaps a little bit closer to Itoh this time round. Itoh, good ride from him tonight.
Great. I mean, if he can just stay back there and, as you say, ride shotgun, that's everything Mick could want.
10 of 22, so not quite halfway yet. But look at the gap they've now got. There's 1, 2, and 3. Here's 4, 5, and there's 6. They're a long way back. Poosh, gee, he dropped back a long way quickly, didn't he?
Yeah. You know, it's probably that arm trouble again, I guess, because you don't sort of fly for the first couple of laps and then drop off the pace so quickly unless you've got some sort of physical problem.
Greville and Kosinski, they've been hard at it, these two. Passed each other a couple of times. Honda, of course, of Greville, and the Kajiva of Kosinski. And whether we'll see Kajiva back next season, let's hope so. They really do add a lot to Grand Prix racing. Any of the Italian top teams, you need them there, but they may concentrate on superbikes next year only.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure they will. They're bringing out a new bike with an engine that's made by Ferrari, and it's going to be absolutely the business. They're going to throw all their effort into the World Superbike.
Where are you going to put that in your garage? You're running out of room.
But it's be a tragedy if they do pull out of it. It's, says a lot for the superbike thing, though, does it?
Certainly does. I suppose that's where you sell the bikes. Ooh, look at this, Kosinski. As Kosinski tucks up the inside. Goes past Greville again, so the Kajiva gets the best of the Honda. We'll take a break, come back shortly. Stay with us, please. Ha! 12 of 22, it's Doohan, Cadalora and Itoh.
I tell you what, Abby is definitely giving Pooch a hard time. Really getting a little bit on the loose side. Let's hope he can keep it all together. But give it another half a lap and I reckon Abby will be in front of Pooch.
Yeah, been a great battle, hasn't it? I mean, Pooch started, remember, off the front row and he's been gobbled up by most of the riders through, and Abby now really throwing out a pretty good challenge. And I tell you what, if there was a few riders behind you, he'd be one I don't think I'd want to have behind me.
I totally agree.
It's too quick.
Well, you know, it's sort of youthful enthusiasm. He's 18 years old, the kid, you know, and Chandler, don't. Yeah. If you see Chandler come out of this corner, he's going to be lucky. Oh, he's found, he's got it. Thank God for that.
Gathered it up.
Oh! Yeah, it's, by the look of it, it's, nice spinner out from the back end. Yeah, it looked like it was some smoke. So maybe she dropped her lunch or broke a hose or something like that. So not quite sure, but he was lucky that he gathered it all up before he got too far into the corner.
So Pooch now and Arby, have a look at Pooch would be saying, well, how many more are going to come at me?
Chandler's had some terrible luck this year when you think about it. You know, it's the bike has broken down 3 or 4 times, and it's really, really sad, you know, because he's riding very well again. And there's nothing more frustrating than when you're riding well on the bike and going, it doesn't finish.
So Pooch and Arby now hard at it. Pooch has, of course, as I said, came off the front row. He's had them all go past him. There's Doohan's pit board goes out.
Plus 7.
So he's just building.
Plus 0.7. can say plus seven. That would be, he'd love to see plus seven at this stage of the game. You see there how Mick picks the bike up a little earlier out there, and that is just so not to give the tyre too hard a time on acceleration. It looks, just looking at the wheels of the bikes and that, they're not sliding around too much as yet. You know, there's 10 laps to run, and I would have thought that if people were going to get in tyre problems, then now really is about the time for it to happen. See, there's it's Greville and Kosinski still at it. See, Kosinski's just pulling away from Greville a little bit now.
Kosinski, I mean, it's been a strange year for Kosinski. When he's really been quick, he's been sensational. Then he'll come out the next week and it'll just be really ordinary.
Yeah, I agree with you. You know, it's just something that's where you get the situation, like I was saying earlier on, that Chandler's had terrible problems in qualifying. You don't really get a good idea as to how good the bikes are going now, because Chandler really... He was in 7th or 8th, there he is there. And it's obviously blown up, I would say, because you saw the... it looked like a mist of oil, smoke, oil or water or something coming out the bike. And you see, if the bike is being pressed absolutely to the limit, you're trying to get a sort of a quart out of a pint pot, you know, that's when they things keep blowing up, you know. So maybe that's why the reliability of the Kajuva hasn't been so good, because their performance hasn't been quite up to the par of the Yamahas or the Hondas, or more especially the Hondas and Suzukis rather. And when they've really pushed them, they're sort of really buzzing them like a bowstring to the limit. And you see their mix is pulling out on Itoh a little bit, and that's when they start blowing up, you see.
I mean, Mick really is riding the way that we've seen him for most of this year. He started slowly at Eastern Creek. I think in the interview that we did at Donington, he said, people expect me to go out and win each time around. It's a long season, and you've got to go hard in the middle of the season when everybody's getting tired. You're carrying little niggling injuries and those sort of things. Yeah, I mean, he's really ridden so smart this year.
Well, when you get as close as he did to winning a world championship, and then you have the luck that he had, you know, the medical disaster he had, you know, it just haunts you for the rest of your life. You know, it's something that is totally out of your control. And, you know, I'm pretty sure that when he started the championship this season, speaking to him, he was in a completely relaxed kind of frame of mind. And his attitude towards the racing this year, he hasn't been as sort of highly strung, if you like, as he was in years gone past.
Oh, I agree with you. I just think he's taken a wonderful attitude to this season, and I think, you know, obviously getting right...
You see
right...
there how he picked the bike, sorry to interrupt, gotcha. You see there, right, just in the last part of the grid, straighten it up really early, was very pronounced there, and that is a definite tyre-saving job. One thing he won't be doing tonight is a last corner slide.
Yeah, you can bet your life on that.
Yeah, the dry cleaner really told him off about it.
Yeah, but it was great when he explained it, wasn't he? He said, I thought I'd just have some fun. I let it slide, then it really started to clip, and I nearly lost it. Kosinski, of course, still laying third in the championship now. We talked that if Kajuva disappears, where does Kosinski pop up this time round?
I don't know, answers on a postcard. I haven't got the faintest idea, really.
Well, it'd be a shame if he's lost.
Because, you see, if... You take this scenario, that if Kajuva retire from racing, my bet would be that they would take... The Roberts lot would take Chandler. And the way Abby's going now, if Abby can keep the whole thing together, then the Yamaha team could be Chandler and Abby. That would keep the Japanese happy. It would keep the Japanese market of Marlborough happy. And... as far as Cadalora is concerned, your guess would be as good as mine.
Gee, there's going to be some talent looking for a ride if that's the case. Anyway, we're only assuming all of that could happen. We don't know that. None of that's been confirmed, but it is a very, very strong rumour.
It's all hypothetical, but
sure,
you know, it's... I don't think it's too far from what could happen.
So Arby here with Poos. They've had a good battle, and Arby's finally got past him. But this young fella has got, obviously, a very big future. if he can stay on the bike, because he's extremely fast. From the moment we first saw him at Suzuka, he just electrified everybody at the circuit. And as we said, we only got a glimpse of him at Donington, unfortunately, he came off.
But you see, he doesn't look anywhere near as desperate here as he did at Suzuka at the beginning of the year.
The first race in front of your home crowd, really? He was so pumped up. The crowd had him pumped up. But amazing talent.
But you see, probably it was good that he went to Donington Park and fell off after three laps and made him really think, hang on a second, I've got to really settle down and take it easy. I'm not going to get anywhere by scratching myself on the road all the time. And that may have been a real favour to him.
Kevin Schwantz again, well back in the field. It's a little sad, I guess, that the champion is so far back on such a crucial race. But he's up to ninth place. He has picked up a spot, but look at the gap. Look at the gap. 35 and a half seconds. That's amazing. Absolutely amazing. And you've got to feel sorry for Schwantz in that situation. I do.
Well, it's so frustrating when the only thing that's holding you back is the fact the bike won't work, and that's all there is to it. There's two ways you can tackle it. The way Kevin would have tackled it 5-6 years ago is completely different to now. 5 or 6 years ago, you see he's hanging his hand at it.
Yeah, he's still that wrist is still a problem, is it?
5 or 6 years ago, Kevin would have torn off like a rat up a drain pipe and probably 3 or 4 laps later been digging it out the straw bales. But, you know, it's the way you learn.
So doing out in front, you'll see Kevin Schwantz. If you haven't seen the races this year, he is carrying a broken bone in his wrist. And every now and then, he holds the hand out and he stretches the fingers to get the circulation going. Doohan, Itoh, Cadalora, Kosinski, Creville, Abe and Poos, McKenzie, Schwantz and Barros.
Just have a listen to the engine.
So Doohan, you get it from onboard, now you get it from the other side. Beautiful lines as he winds his way around this terrific circuit at Brno. This big crowd looking for the new world champion elect, and this will be the man. Long way to go yet. Well, not that long to go. It's only a few laps, but I don't want to put the motor on him. We've got to take a break, gather our breath, come back for the closing stages. Of 22, it's Doohan, Itoh, Cadalora in the top three, Kosinski, Creville and Abe on bike 56 in the points too. Big ride from him. I guess there'd be one guy watching us tonight in Australia, and that'd be the Wollongong whiz, Wayne Gardner. Of course, if Mick can go on and win this race, that will equal Wayne Gardner's record of 18 Grand Prix victories. So the whiz, if you're with us tonight, I guess there's a moment when records are broken, and you've held that 18 strings of victory for a long, long time here in Australia, and Mick Doohan will equal that tonight if he goes on to win this race. Baz, and that puts you one off you. You were 19.
Yeah.
Bonito. Wow.
Just looking, it looks like Abe is catching Kosinski now.
Yeah, he really
just
is.
Down the bottom
we keep saying what a great talent he is, but he's so quick when you consider first time out, not really knowing anything too much about the bikes or the circuits.
I tell you, a guy who really deserves a pat on the back tonight is Itoh, because he hasn't, you know, he hasn't got out of his way to help Mick, if you like, but it's really handy that Itoh popped in front of Cadalora. Because it just cuts you a little bit of slack then, because Cadalora's thinking, oh, you know, he's got to cope with him, and that just gives Mick a little bit of chance to get away a bit further, and it does make life easier for you.
John Kosinski. Quite an amazing character, this man. Can be as quick as anybody on the right machinery.
Oh, that's Creville behind. Sorry, yeah, I thought it was Abbott.
Good ride from Creville tonight, too. It's been a season of ups and downs for Creville.
I tell you what, the old... I'd love it. It's a shame we couldn't get a readout from Mick's brain at the moment. It's what's going on in his head. I mean, he's thinking, oh,
the heart rate would be the one, I reckon.
Oh, 4 laps or however many laps it
absolutely
is.
Absolutely pounding. Mine is.
That's right, you're mad.
That's not a good sign.
Yeah, I've been around you when it wasn't pounding.
Well, there's no beach around, I'm safe. I don't know why we're looking at Creville. Can we please go back and have a look at bike number four? Out in front, same colours. Pretty lonely ride now for Creville, but Kaczynski, you can see, is still trying, isn't he?
As you say, it's so important. We could normally say, right, OK, the leader's disappeared, but the gap between Doohan and Itoh is not even as big as this gap. And it's more exciting because the guy that he's leading happens to be going to be the world champion if he wins it. So what are we looking at this for?
Yeah, world champion elect, I guess we've got to say, because obviously the world championship crown belongs to Kevin Schwantz till a new season. But bike number one will be the number that this man will carry if he can continue to do what he's doing for the next four laps. So Mick Doohan looking pretty safe at the moment. Itoh sits in behind him, and that's good news. Yeah. I'll tell you what, he hasn't backed off any. There's the gap back to Itoh, 2.102 seconds. There's Itoh there, one and two. So Mick really has wound it up now. He's just getting a bit more space between he and his teammate. But he'd feel pretty good about Ito's ride tonight, sitting in behind him.
Yeah, it's a great ride for me. So he's just pulled away from Cadalora pretty easily. You cannot believe how long these last few laps would look like someone had fallen off there. You see all the scratch marks in the road. Yeah, you couldn't believe how long the last four or so laps will be. Oh, it just drives you mad.
Well, Barry, I don't know. In my my lifetime of sport, I've seen so many Australians buy and win world championships, but I don't think there's been an Australian that I can recall that I believe deserves a championship any more than Michael Doohan. I mean, when we saw his leg at Kyle Army, I couldn't believe he was up and walking, let alone racing a motorcycle. We know what he's been through with that. That's all behind him now. But by gee, the torment that he's had, the torture that he's had to go on and do this.
Jeremy Burgess,
he's been a tower of strength, hasn't he?
He's got a great team doing, really good bunch of blokes with him.
But I say that with all the respect of Australians who've won world championships, but gee whiz, you could not deny this fellow anything in his life. He has paid his dues big time.
The great thing about it is that Mick will appreciate this world championship more than he could have ever appreciated the other one. Do you understand what I mean? Because to really appreciate the good times, you've got to have some real lousy ones, and he's been all through that. And when it does come good, it's just so sweet.
Three laps to go, and Michael Doohan leads Itoh now. This massive crowd getting behind him, they can sense some greatness here, because the Australian will be the second man to hold the 500cc crown. Wayne Gardner, of course, did that for us in the 80s, and it'll be Doohan's turn in the 90s. Just a few more laps to go, and I just can't believe this is happening, because it's taken what seems to be an eternity to get into the position to win this championship.
Oh, yeah, that's for us. How do you think he feels?
Oh, I can't imagine.
Listening to the soundtrack from this, acceleration-wise, it sounds like the tyres performing okay. It doesn't sound like it's spinning a lot. You listen to this. Well, you can't hear it so well on that one, but when you get an onboard camera shot on the acceleration out of the corner, but you can't hear the tyre spinning or anything, so... And as I said before, I'm sure he won't be spinning it on purpose anymore.
Well, I'm pretty impressed. I mean, he hasn't backed off in any way. He's ridden this race to win, and he's always said if he feels comfortable on the bike, then he'll wring its neck. If he doesn't feel like it, that's what he wants to do, he cruises back a little. But he's gone from the word go to win this race. Troubles in qualifying. Got on the front row behind Cadalora, or beside Cadalora. Cadalora was no match for him tonight. I mean, he has just blasted Cadalora into oblivion. There's the gap.
The master are going faster tonight. There's no doubt whatsoever about that. He's gone good right from the word go.
Well, he's gone out to win the race, and I just think it's been a great attitude. He said, if I feel comfortable and I think I can do it, then I'll give it the go. But, you know, I'm sure that he's amazed that Schwantz is so far back. And Cadalora's just been no match. He's just been brilliant tonight. Just a couple of laps to go. Wonderful setting here. Massive crowd. Traffic in front. Won't even worry him. He won't even see him. You're saying in the 250 race, Barry, how wide this circuit is. I mean, the bikes look quite tiny on it, don't they?
Well, they do. You know, it's they've certainly left enough room for anywhere, any line, any chosen line that anybody wants to take. I don't think I've seen a racetrack as wide as this anywhere. You know, they've made it big enough so that you could put about four Formula One cars side by side and there'd still be room. It's good, you know, they made a sensational job of the circuit. Your heart's beginning to thump a bit hard now.
Yeah, getting close, isn't it? As Doohan winds around, if we're in problems, imagine what's going inside that helmet. The crew would have everything crossed up. His family in Queensland, you must be so proud. You've waited for so long for this to happen, as we all have right round Australia. He's a great ambassador, this fellow, and he's just wonderful for the sport. And his whole attitude this year has just changed, and I've seen a complete change in Mick Doohan this year, and it's really been a delight to watch him just attack the season the way that he has done.
See, the bat marker's having a real good look there.
And now he's there, and he has the respect of everybody that rides a motorcycle, this fellow. Rounds him up as he comes around yet another corner closer.
That's Darrell and Marco Papa.
Another good look as the Doohan comes through.
Last lap.
Here we go. 5.394 kilometres to go for Michael Doohan. Itoh, terrific job sitting in second place. Cadalora be no match on the Yamaha tonight.
Oh, Kaczynski.
Oh, that's bad luck. Kaczynski obviously got some bike trouble, so he's out. And I really felt a bit sorry for Kaczynski this year. I think his attitude's changed for the better this year. He's been terrific to work with when we've had that chance. And he certainly hasn't had too much luck. But when he's been on the money, he's been quick. Final lap now for Michael Doohan. The World Championship now, just a few corners away.
You see, and he can afford to relax now because Ito's eased off the pace quite a lot, which is it's great for Mick, you know, because you don't have to push on when you've got someone breathing right down your neck, you know, between you and a World Championship. So you can go into the last lap and you've got the whole last lap to think of the muck-ups you can make.
Number one will be on the plate next year instead of four. And boy, oh boy, here we go. Look at this world champion getting it ready. Isn't that fantastic?
Yeah, lovely.
And this team has worked so hard, I've got to say it. I know that every team works hard, and I feel a little bit sorry for Kevin Schwantz. He hasn't been able to fight the championship the way that he wanted to, but this man, the Aussie, gee whiz, he's done a terrific job this year. He's attacked this championship year on a bike that he's been comfortable with, on a body that's finally healed, and the result has just been sensational.
It'll be interesting to see what kind of emotion Mick shows at the end of this. He's having a look behind, see what the weenie situation is going to be.
Where are you? There's no one there. He's just in a world of his own at the moment.
That's so you can set up for a real night, for a real good finale, that look behind.
Yeah,
you see
watch. He doesn't look behind him that often.
No, I think we'll find...
Here we go.
Not long.
Comes up. He's done it.
Yay!
Australia's Michael Doohan, the world champion-elect, wins the Czech Republic Grand Prix. Imagine the emotion underneath that helmet. Cadalora flashes across the line. It doesn't matter.
Oh, Itoh,
his
great
teammate on bike seven, was second. But he's finally done it. Michael Doohan has finally done it. The world championship is his. Second Australian to do so. Wayne Gardner was the first. Here's the Aussie flag, and have a look at the Aussie. How pumped up is he?
Oh, boy, he's happy.
He said, take the flag shot. Terrific stuff. There he is, obviously been waiting for Mick to come round. He's got the flag. Get him going again, and you can see Australia's flags here in this crowd, Barry. Well, you've had the pleasure that few of us in this world share to win a world championship, and there it is, he's done.
It just feels so good, I can't tell you. You know, you'd ride up there and you think, I can't believe I just won the world championship. And it's not until you get back to the hotel or whatever that night, you think, yeah, no one can take this away from me. And you, even the hangover you've got the next morning, no one can take it away from you.
So there we go, Arby comes up behind him, Mapu's just right in behind him. And there's champagne going everywhere, Aussie flags are up. And I'm not quite sure, we're having a look back obviously now. The Czech television people are throwing a bit of tape in here from Mick's previous wins. taking the flag around. Why we can't see the one that he's just won, I'm not quite sure.
Whoa! Oh,
there's a slide. So they're recapping the races he's won this year on the way to the championship. World champion Michael Doohan. Fantastic. Australia, be proud of this man, I tell you. The character, the courage, the determination he's shown to win this championship is just unparalleled.
That ain't bad. He's had 8 wins this year, and if he wins the remaining 3, does that establish some kind of record, Phil? I think.
Well, I think it does. But yeah, he's certainly equal Wayne Gardner's record.
I'm sure that equals Agostini's record of Grand Prix wins of the year.
This massive crowd giving him a tremendous ovation. He goes around, and there's plenty of Aussies there. I'll tell you, there are plenty of Aussies in the crowd. Kevin Schwantz coming up beside him. There's the moment.
So nice.
There's the moment. The Texan concedes the championship win to Michael Doohan and drops straight off. Wasn't that a nice thing to do? Enjoy the lap, he says. So it's Doohan, Itoh, Cadalora, Creville, Puig, and Arby. That's how they finished. We'll come back for the champagne. Ah, get it out of the fridge, Australia. Start spraying it around. We've got a new champ on our hands. Well, there we go. Michael Doohan handing his helmet over to Jeremy Burgess, who has been a tower of strength with him the entire time that he's been with Honda. And I don't think there'd be any prouder guy than Jeremy Burgess either.
Oh, without any doubt. And all Mick's guys are a really good bunch of blokes. You know, he's got a little close-knit team of 4 people. And when you see all the effort they put in all through the year, and, you know, they suffer, you know, your bad times and they enjoy your good times and that. But when it all comes together, it's just so good. I can't explain how nice it is. It's great.
Well, let's have a listen to the man himself, Richard Nichols. He's been asking the question of Mick for about the last 5 Grand Prix, and Mick wouldn't talk about it. It'll be interesting to see what he says now.
Can we talk about it now?
Well, I guess so, yeah.
How does it feel?
It feels good to actually kind of win it. I didn't know, you know, I didn't talk about it because we hadn't won it, and I didn't want to talk about something I haven't got, so it feels good to actually clinch it. You know, I've been lucky all year with Kevin having some problems, and this weekend as well, he couldn't get the bike working the way he wanted. So, you know, the Honda team's been working real hard all year, and the Michelin's been perfect, the L-Fuel, everything. So I owe a lot to a lot of people, especially Dr. Costa and, you know, the Italian people that helped me back in 92. Without them, I wouldn't be here. I wouldn't have a leg, so I'm happy.
Party tonight?
Well, I got a plane to catch, but
you're always leaving early, aren't you?
Well, I just have to see what happens, I guess, yeah.
I think you've got to stay here. Michael, congratulations. I know everybody wants to do that, and I'm privileged. Well
Thank
done.
You.
Couple of keys there. Mentioning Dr. Costa, that was fantastic. With that T-shirt that Mick is wearing, one of Mick's saying is no worries, and he said it from the time that he went into Grand Prix racing. They'd ask him all these questions: how's the bike? No worries. How's the tyres? No worries. You got to get the plane tonight? No worries.
Yeah, no worries.
So the T-shirt reads, World Champion 1994, no worries. I think that's great.
That's great, really. When I saw Mick last time at Donington, I said, well, the next call I want is when you're drunk after Checo. So if it's 3 o'clock in the morning, I'm sure Stephanie will love it.
Well, let's cross now over to the podium for the champagne spraying. National anthem being played, and I must say this to people around Australia. We get a lot of letters about why don't we show this and why don't we show that. We've waited for so long for the moment of Mick Doohan to win this championship, and the Czech television, I've got to tell you, have lost the whole moment. Whilst Mick has been trying to celebrate his championship, we've seen every race he's ever won in the last 3 years. I mean, it really is frustrating. We've waited for this moment for so long, and I can't believe what they've done. But anyway, there it is. There's the champagne being sprayed. So, and have a look at the T-shirt. No worries. I love it. Luca Cadalora coming over and saying well done. The Australians in the crowd there making their way around. So let's recap the results for you.
Well, there we go. Really important win for our Mick. And second place, Itoh, Cadalora, Creville, Pooch and Abbey. Championship points now. Well, the top two don't change. Kevin Schwantz can't be beaten for second. It's really interesting for third place between Pooch and Creville, and pretty close with Kaczynski there. And the way Itoh was going tonight, so I wouldn't be at all surprised to see him get in the first three.
Yeah, sure. OK, we're going to take a break. We've got the 250s coming up. Another good dice there for you to enjoy because they've been great. A little later on, too, we'll acknowledge another young Australian who really was amongst the world championships in speedway racing. More news about that when we come back, so stay with us. I feel a bit numb. Comes onto the main straight area, blast down, he'll take the...
Yay!
And Michael Doohan takes victory number five.
Great!
What a ride.
Sensational.
Joe, won't forget that ride at Suzuka in the rain. That was the night that Wayne Gardner crash broke his leg. And I think that accident overshadowed Mick's ride, which was like the perfect ride in the rain.
That was one of his best ever rides, I think, when you consider what the conditions were like that day. Were pretty lousy.
Absolutely atrocious. I don't know about you at home, but I feel like a little numb. You know, we've waited so long for Michael Doohan to win that championship. I am just the happiest person for that man. All right, the show must go on. And, of course, the 250s have been sensational this year. There's been no doubt about that. The Biaggi, well, the parade will happen again because he's very fast, Biaggi. And Caparossi has been challenging him. They've had some ding-dong battles throughout the year. Let's pick up the action of lap 16 of the 250cc Grand Prix. You're going to enjoy this one as well.
It's not going to be easy for Caparossi.
No. No way.
I would say Caparossi, if he gets close enough, he's going to do Waldman where Waldman did him, and that's as they come over the crest of a hill into that left-hander there, because Caparossi's pretty quick into that. And that's what makes me think that he must have made some muck-up at the previous corner for Waldman to have got past him so easily.
Well, here I just said Ruggia's got to sit back and watch the battle up in front, and again, he closes up. So, wow, I mean, it's all on here, isn't it, for second, third and fourth. Great dice. Biaggi, he's out in front.
I had a great letter from a lady that was... there's Biaggi just on the left of the picture. A letter from a lady that was a real... great fan of Biaggi's, and she says, oh, don't give poor Biaggi a hard time, and I know you don't mean it in this. She says, he's my little licorice also, I could eat him, you know, because of his colour, you know, the colours of his bike and all that kind of stuff. So if you're listening, we haven't given him a hard time tonight. He doesn't deserve it. He deserves a pat on the back if he keeps
licorice
it up.
Licorice also. There we go. It's a new twist. So it's Waldman now. Caparossi in behind him. Ruggia, the battle for second, third and fourth. Biaggi, he's not that far in front, you know. I mean, if he's timed it, he's timed it to perfection. He's just had a pretty good look. Oh, was it 35?
No, that was that back
35.
Mark.
Yeah, well, that was the right thing to do. Because here they come, steaming across his line. They'll be rounding him up pretty quickly. He'd want to get out of the way of this mob. But there's Biaggi and there's the gap. Traffic in front.
Right, so that's Waldman passed and Caparossi passed and Ruggia passed.
All get through. Mind you, he really just stayed on the inside line. Get round me if you can. As you said, there's enough track here that you could have five races going on. Waldman, Caparossi, intense battle for second place. Important too.
Oh, it really is, because don't forget, if Biaggi wins tonight, that gives him a 5 point over the second place, and I believe it's another three. It's 8 points. 8 points. He pulls back then 8 points on Caparossi.
Yeah, Waldman, I think, seems to have Caparossi's measure, but we've said this before. Caparossi, to me, I mean, he seems to get as close as he can, and Waldman has a little bit in reserve. He appears that he can just pull that fraction of a second out of Caparossi having looked for Ruggia.
But don't forget what Caparossi's, you know, we've seen Caparossi in France, that last lap where he and Romboni were together. It was quite exceptional, you know, and Caparossi's, when the chips are down, he can deliver the goodies.
Biaggi has really timed his race to perfection tonight. Just kept enough gap there that he could just take it a little bit easy. Just save his tyres, save the machine, save himself. So Caparossi now running out of laps. If he's going to get second place, he's got to do it pretty quickly. Waldman, here they go. Watch this.
So he's just picking up the slipstream, but not quite close enough.
Three to go. Waldman just sticking to the task, staying to his line, just keeping it all nice and tidy.
Now, watch it over here. This is where he's going to get him.
Yep.
And that's around that left-hander going up that hill. I'm sure that Caparossi must have made a mistake going up there for Waldman to have come past him that quickly. But I'm pretty sure that if he doesn't do it beforehand, that is going to be the place he's going to go for.
So Biaggi again has increased his lead to enough. I mean, 5.9 seconds at this stage of the race. He's home and host. Oh, dare I say it. Waldman there. This is the interest here. Ruggia, will he have a last lap lunge? You got it. Tucks himself down low. I tell you what, he's still there.
He's catching Caparossi. He could really outfox everybody and come from nowhere and do the pair of them.
Waldman looks comfortable to me. He looks like he's got Caparossi well and truly covered. May I be that bold? Waldman.
Well, he does, you're right. You're right, he does, he looks good.
I haven't seen him flustered. He hasn't really been looking. He had one quick look about four or five laps ago and that's it. He hasn't worried since. Seems to me that he thinks, I've got him covered, I've just got to stick to my task. Biaggi now, he's really had the perfect race. He's led from the word go. Fantastic ride from Biaggi.
He's not backing it off at all, Biaggi. You see there where he pitched her into the corner. He was right on the entrance to the pit lane, right across the yellow checkers there. So he's definitely not eased her off.
And there's the gap, 1, 2, 3, 4. Probably the biggest margin we've seen as long as I can remember
for a 250, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, they've been so close all year.
Hello. It's been on now. Right, now watch out. No, he's not close enough there. See, on change of direction, if he can get a good slipstream up here, but I don't think he's close enough.
Nope.
Ooh.
Ooh, yeah, closer than last time.
Her up there. Yeah.
So Waldman still doing the right thing. It's a different line there too. Caparossi takes the same sort of line that Ruggia takes through there.
Yeah, that's a funny thing when you get such a wide circuit as this. You know, you can sort of sacrifice a bit going into an S's like that. You either gain a bit coming in or gain a bit coming out. You can't gain going in and coming out. Does that make any sense?
Yeah.
Not a lot.
So Waldman now still in second place. Caparossi running out of corners, running out of places to do it. And I think Barry was right. The only place over the crest of the hill, but I don't think he's close enough now. Waldman, no. Pretty comfortable.
He's really got to get right on the backside of Waldman on that right-hander before they start going into the left and up the hill. Otherwise, we'll tell this round, it's got to be a quarter of that distance. Otherwise, there's another snowballing hell's chance.
So Caparossi was in second place. Waldman just really ground him down. And once he got past him, he opened up a little bit of a gap. He's continuing to do that. And a good ride tonight from Waldman. An excellent ride from Biaggi out in front.
So, Guy, the ride from Waldman, I think, is real class. Real good drop of stuff. You know, when you've got to take into account how little experience he's had in this class. And it's a good ride.
Yeah. Aoki, wow, he's like, forget it. He'll finish tomorrow behind Ruggia. So Ruggia can't catch him now. The battle for second and third is on now. Last lap coming up.
Well, he's got to get right late on the brakes here and get not close enough there. He's got to make up a lot of ground out of this round this next. No. You see, that's where he needed to be, right behind Waldman. And he's not, there's nowhere near enough time for him to. Oh!
I had a corner.
Yeah, I know. I thought, where's Waldman?
You know, there was no chance. Thought he might.
Oh! And there's the end result. Oh. Tried so hard. Oh, boy, that was a big one. Came down hard, but he's A-OK, trying to pick the bike up. Oh, boy. Just came down so hard.
Leave him alone. Don't push him.
Well, if you wonder how hard they try, there's the evidence right in front of you. Well, watch it again.
Watch. That's pattering on the front. Starts bouncing on the front, and then it gets him in a bit deep. Then he puts the power on here and starts to go there. Watch. Wallop. Oh. Yuck.
That is a hard slap,
that's
isn't it?
That's a nasty one.
She was up quick, though. They're tough, these fellas.
But you see what started that? Where he went in, it started to bounce on the front. That lost him a bit of ground. And he thought, oh, I'm losing on Waldman. And then got on the power early and bit him.
So Biaggi now all set to take this. This is his fourth win of the season, Biaggi. The Czech Republic Grand Prix, been a fantastic ride.
And that will put him 1 point in front of Caprossi now.
Up goes the wheel. The crowd got behind him.
A 1 point, one point.
An absolute blinder of a ride. He couldn't have ridden a better race tonight, Biaggi. Been sensational. Well, still mixing it with the traffic. I mean, you want to get out of there. Get across the line the best way you can. There he is, Biaggi. Flashes down the start-finish line, takes a checker flag.
Let's see if Caprossi...
Pretty happy. Waldman takes second. Great ride from him. Doing a Schwantz. I love them when they win and they enjoy it.
Be interesting to see if Caprossi... He got going again, but we don't know how much of his bike was left as to whether he could get to the end.
You see, Waldman there was having a good look to see where Caprossi was. I mean, he would have heard something behind him, undoubtedly.
The flag.
There it is. This is the tradition now in Grand Prix racing. Plenty of emotion here. Biaggi taking the Italian flag. Fan jumps over, gives it to him. Away he goes now. So Biaggi up on the wheel. Good wheel, he was. Look at Waldman. He's pretty happy. Biaggi coming up behind him now. Celebrates his fourth win of the season. And the perfect ride. Couldn't ask for a better ride.
Was a good ride, wasn't it? That's a right. Biaggi from Waldman, Jean-Philippe Rougier, Aoki Okada and Jean-Michel Bale. Championship points. Now, there's the thing. I was right. Biaggi's leading by 1 point from Caprossi, Okada, Waldman, Romboni and Jean-Philippe Rougier.
Yeah, Caprossi, gee whiz, he slapped down hard, didn't he?
Oh, he did, you know, it's the usual sort of panic. You lose a bit of ground, you think, yeah, too late.
Interesting, I mean, you don't like to reflect back to it, but that's a similar accident to the way that Wayne Rainey fell.
Exactly the same kind of thing. It just kicked that way and then pushed him off that side. And it's just shows you how unlucky you can be and how lucky you can be sometimes.
Exactly. Well, good win to Biaggi. And, of course, that keeps that championship alive and well. If you've just joined us, if you've just got home, Michael Doohan is the world champion-elect. A great win tonight. Now, when we talk about great wins, we don't hear a lot about Speedway in this country, but Speedway in Europe is huge, isn't it?
Enormous. In Czechoslovakia, for example, it's absolutely monstrous.
Well, a ride from young Craig Boyce, now he's from Moorbank in Sydney, came third at the World Speedway Championship Final. It was held in Voins in Sweden. Now, it was Craig's debutante world final. What a fantastic result. Now, the winner was Tony Rickardsen from Sweden. Hans Nielsen from Denmark was second. At the end of the 20 qualifying heats, all three riders were level pegging on points and were forced to ride a four-lap decider. Now, this was led by Boyce, and like about 50 metres out, Rickardsen passed him on the outside to snatch the win. Now, another Australian, Jason Crump from Queensland, came in 12th, and last weekend he finished third in the under-21 World Championship. So a lot of talent in Speedway, and we've got a nice Speedway story coming your way in the hopefully next weekend or maybe the weekend after that on Nine's Wide World of Sports. Now, the American Superbike race at Sears Point, Australian Troy Corsa qualified on pole. He leads the American Championship by 18 points. Only an engine failure in the earlier round had prevented him, Corsa, from already winning the championship. So Australians at the moment, I mean, we're winning gold like we've never seen in Canada. We've just won the World 500cc Championship for 1994. The youngster Boyce getting a third in the World Speedway Final. I don't think people understand how difficult a job that is.
Well, it's, you know, I feel a little bit, just talking about the Commonwealth Games at the moment, I feel a little bit sorry for Mick because he couldn't have won the championship at a worse time when, you know, Australia is blitzing them in the Commonwealth Games. Yeah. And it's just unfortunate for Mick that it coincides with his world championship.
I'm sure he'll get the right press. Now, of course, Darrell Beattie is back on deck for the next round at Laguna Seca, so that's good that foot of his healed up pretty well. But just finally on that speedway thing, I mean, it's a monumental effort to get a third place. And I mean, he really only missed out by half a lap.
Yeah, but what a terrible thing to go into the final. Here's your world championship. Mm. You've got three laps with four people in it. Mm. It's a bit of a sort of a psychological job, I should think.
All righty, and some good news for speedway fans because the best riders in the world are coming to Australia for a 13-round series that will be like a super series here, and we'll bring you up to date with that more when I get more information. But fantastic. All the best riders, including the world champion, will be here. All right, let's have a look at what's coming your way on Nine's Wide World of Sports, Laguna Seca. That's the next big one, Sunday, the 11th of September. There's still a bit to be decided in this world championship for the minor placings. So that's going to be a good race. Always is good there, too, down through that roller coaster. New England IndyCar Grand Prix from New Hampshire. Tuesday, 23rd of August, that's 12:10 Eastern Standard Time. Join me for that one. Let's have a look at the grid. It's interesting, Paul Tracy again in the Penske. Gee, was there being good. Teo Fabi, that's really good to see him up that far up the grid. Raoul Boissel, Nigel Mansell in fourth. Mario Andretti in his final appearance there in the fifth spot there. And Al Unser Jr., who is just screaming away with the championship, is in the top six. Baseball, haven't they had their problems? Strikes and everything, but the best of the Major League Baseball. We keep it coming at you. Wednesday, the 24th of August, 1:30 a.m. Eastern Time. Check your guides all around Australia. So it's been an amazing week of sport. To all of our athletes up in Canada, we say fantastic. I mean, that just goes on. But I just feel like somebody has lifted the biggest weight off my shoulders. I know it's a stupid thing for me to say, but I'm so happy for Mick Doohan.
Well, you're quite right. You know, when you think you're going back to what happened last time and you just think, well, like, you're sure that something was going to go wrong, you know, but I'm going for a drink now.
Safe trip home. Okay, loves that water. We'll see you next time round. Oh, no, before we go, happy birthday
oh,
to Michael,
yes,
Williams.
Michael Williams.
Our producer, the super pom. It's his birthday tonight. He's driven us mad, let me tell you. So we'll see you next time round on Nine's Wide World of Sports. Happy birthday to you.
9's Wide World of Sports. The 1994 500cc Grand Prix Telecast, proudly sponsored by Zurich Insurance, Valvoline, and Ultratune.